Market Immobilienscout 24 here in Berlin. And I'm not here to talk about real estate. I'm actually here to talk about something very low on the tech package, which we use to serve you up nice real estate listings, which is iPixie, the versatile network bootloader. You can find me on Twitter or email. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to drop me a note. If you make photos, please tweet them also with my tag so that I can see them later. Thanks a lot. And if you have questions, you can also raise your hand and we'll just take a short break and there will be also space for questions at the end. So, pre-boot execution environment. Let's ask who's using this stuff. Okay. Who came here to learn about Pixie boot or automated computer installations? Okay. I hope you'll be taking home something useful. For those who want to know more about Pixie or network boot in general, those are two fairly good resources I would recommend for starters. And as usual, in the end, you'll have to Google the answers to your questions because there's lots of mailing lists and lots of other infos which are a little bit deeper hidden on the internet. Let's ask who was using RPL back in its heydays. Anybody? Old enough? Cool. Or other boot? Did you ever flash a boot ROM? Cool. I like those people. Let's see. RIS. Anybody using that? Ah, don't worry. It's no shame. Kickstart, AutoYast, FAI. Okay, great. So that's the crowd I'm talking with. So today I would like to speak about one particular form of network booting with the help of iPixie. iPixie actually has an old history. It started out as Etherboot a long time ago. The Etherboot project then turned into GPixie. And if you ever check the GPixie Git repository, you'll notice that the last commit is about 3 years ago. So obviously this is dead. Luckily, a few years ago, a guy forked GPXE into iPXE, and iPXE is actively being developed, and that's the reason I'm talking about it today. A little bit about iPXE. There's a nice website, which looks a bit like the clone of the GPXE website, but it actually contains also more and different stuff. iPXE in general is a full PXE boot implementation. And the PXE implementation means that it fulfills this PXE boot standard which Intel set up in the last decade, or like in the last century actually. And it extends this PXE boot standard with a lot of useful features. For example, iPXE can boot over HTTP, which is also the reason why we are using it. But it can also do much more. It can, for example, allow you to boot block devices from the network, which is a very unique feature. And I'll be talking a bit more about that. Essentially, it allows you to create your own homebrew network block device booting network card, or HBA, host bus adapter, and something where you usually would pay hundreds and thousands of euros for, you can basically get for free just by flashing this iPXE code into your regular cheapomatic network card. It also supports AOE booting, which is pretty unique. iSCSI HBAs are also common on the market now, but AOE booting is really special. And if you are looking into building a very low-cost network block device solution, then AOE is an interesting option. It can support virtual LANs, VLAN tagging. It supports Wi-Fi, so you can actually boot over Wi-Fi and do remote installations over Wi-Fi if you want, which I think is really crazy and cool. I never tried it myself, but just the option of being able to do so is really cool. And of course, you can install stuff over the internet, which is just the extension of HTTP booting. You can boot from InfiniBand, which I never tried. You have an extensive set of scripting commands in the bootloader, which actually allows you to put a lot of business logic into the bootloader. And that is something which we are using a lot. And I think any more complex boot environment where you have to take decisions while booting requires this kind of capability from the bootloader. And that's the reason why I'm showing you this code today, so that you can also improve the intelligence of your boot environment. And last, also very important, you can program IPXE into any network card that allows ROM flashing. And that's a very cool way how to actually add IPXE to your hardware. And if you, for example, want to boot over Wi-Fi, then that's the only way how to accomplish that without any storage media in the computer. Because the network card actually has a flash area which you can use as a storage media for the boot code. A few words about this nice guy on the side. Sorry, this is Michael. He's the main developer of IPXE. He has a GitHub account. He's easily reachable through IRC and other channels. And he's also the reason that IPXE is alive, because he actually keeps working on it. And I'll come back to that later. How do you get it? Really simple. If you run a Debian system, you can just install it from the package repositories. A bit outdated, but it's okay. It's good for starters, and there are actually also packages that integrate IPXE with KVM and QMO, which shows that actually it's part of the mainstream solution on these systems, even though you maybe haven't noticed it so far. And under QMO, actually IPXE serves as the PXE ROM implementation, which is usually found on network cards. If you need an RPM, you need to build it yourself. The usual RPM distributions don't ship it, as far as I know. To make it easier, you can just use our GitHub repository, which contains a spec file and a make RPM, make SRPM. So it's really easy to build IPXE from that. You actually get our customizations to the configuration as well, which enable a few settings which are off by default. Customizing is an important keyword, because IPXE comes heavily stripped down by default, and most of the really cool features need to be enabled manually. The way how to do that is using cheader files. So you go to the source code, and there are cheader files which you just copy, like .h files, and then you can add stuff. For example, to set a German key map, you just add those two lines to the config local console.h file, and then you build it with make or make RPM, and then you get a custom build that has a German key map. That's actually a good example for why we like to use this IPXE bootloader, because in the build process, we can already set many things which, when we use PXE Linux from the SysLinux project, actually have to be added manually by loading additional stuff. So here it's all built in. I don't need to load any modules. It's just one bootloader that does all the magic. How do you use it? Well, obviously you have to load it. You have to get it onto the computer. And when we talk about pre-boot environments in general, this is a very important question, because pre-boot means that it's a blank computer that doesn't run anything. It runs the BIOS when you switch it on. There's no hard disk and nothing installed. So basically, there are three ways how to get it to run. One is use the undie-only kpxe file, which means that you use the undie driver. Undie stands for Universal Network Device Interface, or something like that. And it's basically a standard set by Intel, which gives a standard API of how to talk with a network card, and all PXE boot-enabled network cards actually implement this interface, so that if you have a PXE boot-enabled network card, which is nowadays all network cards, then this network card supports undie, and then you can use IPXE with the undie driver and just chain load it on your PXE boot process. I'll show you in a second how. The alternative to that is actually the real IPXE build, which is bigger, because it contains network card drivers. And the benefit of doing that is that IPXE runs much faster, and the network transfers it does are much faster. And that's the only way how you can actually access all network cards in the pre-boot environment, which is a severe limitation of the PXE concept in general. Because usually, when you boot, you only see the network card which you booted from, but you don't see that maybe there are three other network cards which are also relevant. And there are many environments where you have to boot from one network card and then use another network card with some VLAN tagging to access anything real for security purposes, or because you have just lots of VLANs and you do trunking on your Ethernet cables and so on. And IPXE is a way how you can do network boots in such an environment. The last version is a single driver build, which is the PCI ID of the network card you're building for, .rom. You create that by typing make, bin, and PCIID.rom, and then it builds a custom-made binary just for that network card, and that is the binary you then flash into the, into the network card using the normal flash utilities that your network card vendor supplies. For example, for Intel, there's a DOS diskette, which allows you to flash it. When you use the all drivers build, there are different ways how to load it, and it creates different binaries, which are just different forms of loading. For example, ISO obviously is a CD image, just half a megabyte large or 1 megabyte large. DSK is a floppy disk, USB is a hard disk. LKRN is a Linux kernel compatible file, so you can load it with Linux, IPXE LKRN from another bootloader. And IPXE.pxe is an actually PXE boot file, which you can use when you do PXE booting. And in all places where so far you had been using pxelinux.0, that's the file you would place instead, and it doesn't have to be named .0, by the way. That's just a syslinux convention. PXE chain loading is simple. In your DHCP configuration, you just use undi only as a file name, and then you go. There's actually one problem with that, because the PXE code of the network card retrieves that file name, executes it, but what it executed is actually a PXE bootloader, so we do again a DHCP request, and then again get the information your file name is so-and-so, download it, execute it, so you get into a loop. And the way how to break the loop is actually by providing an action, which should happen after that. So here we need to distinguish between block device booting and scripting. When you do block device booting, then you use the root path DHCP parameter, which is a standard parameter, to tell IPXE what's the block device to boot. And that could be an iSCSI address like here. It could be an FCOE address for FCOE, InfiniBand, or AOE, whatever you need. You just write it there, and then we'll boot that block device. And that's actually a way how you even can boot stuff like Windows. It works. Very cool, very impressive when you see it working, and that's, for my understanding, like the, really the missing link between using network block device on, for example, hardware. The other way is scripting. In scripting, you use such a piece of code in your DHCP configuration to distinguish between the request coming from the integrated PXE ROM in the network card and from the IPXE network request, because the IPXE code will send the user class flag in its DHCP request and set it to IPXE, and that's how you can distinguish it from a plain PXE request. And then you can just say, if IPXE is asking, let's give it a script, and the script, of course, can be served by a program on a web server, and that's how you go into dynamic scripting, dynamically generated scripts, and that's how you can really take control over the entire boot process. And if it's not user class PXE, then it's probably the network card itself that's asking, and then we just serve it our improved PXE boot code. Bit about advanced usage. NIC flashing, very nice. Unfortunately, you have to do it for every NIC. And there's a website on the, there's a how to do that. It's pretty simple. It works very reliable on most modern cards. And for Wi-Fi, what you usually do is you take an old 100 Mbit card just for the flash. Flash it, put it in, computer boots off the 100 megabit card, and then goes and starts to use the Wi-Fi. What other stuff you can do? You can do a login mask, so you can have a pre-boot authentication network-based. The computer comes up, shows your login mask, user types a username and password. The script running on IPXE sends all that to the server, and then the server can decide boot or not boot. And of course, there's a lot of more interaction. You can use all kind of variables which are available and which contain useful information about the system. And all that you can easily send to the server that way. Maybe it's a cheap way of doing inventory scans. Every server, every system, when booting, sends all the relevant information to some server and continues booting from the local hard disk. Could be as simple as that. And of course, use your own fantasy and the scripting how-to. Testing, very important. Please test before production. And we do automate, so we also do automated tests. The two simple things, two simple ways how to test. Basically, you can use QEMU with such a command line to test a script which you download via TFTP or HTTP. And the trick of using TFTP is actually the built-in TFTP server that QEMU activates if you run it like that. Very, very quick and easy way to check out a script. Or you can use VirtualBox. My typical setup looks like that. Start from the IPXE ISO. And again, use TFTP, just you have to tell VirtualBox how to find that. A little bit more complex example of scripting. That's a script we actually use in production at Immobilien Scout as a disaster recovery tool, because it allows us to either boot automatically via DHCP, and if the DHCP server isn't there, then it will ask us to enter IP configuration, configure the network card with that IP information, and then download the actual IPXE boot script and do all the booting and installing from there. And that's a way how we actually have a fallback plan how to install servers in case the DHCP server is out. You see, it's not much actually, but it adds an important layer of safety to our entire platform. You probably want to see it in action, so I prepared a video, because I'm not doing live demos. Let's hope it works over my connection. Yeah. So, here we see some typical things. I'm sorry, it's cut off on the left side. Oh, yeah. Beamer alignment fail, I'm so sorry. What you see is basically there's a prompt, I'm doing echo, wait, I can actually make it smaller. And you can like get yourself some information about variables, vendor is not set. That's the menu. I can boot the local disk, of course, which is in this case a Scientific Linux. You can basically do everything you know already from other PXE bootloaders like SysLinux, but in my opinion, you can do it much more convenient. And it also downloads HTTP stuff much faster. Like, it's actually one of the reasons we're going to move a lot of things to IPXE, because we have very slow HTTP downloads with SysLinux. And newer SysLinux versions don't work. That's the configuration dialog where you can see all the settings, you can see all the variables which are available in a simple GUI. And everything you see here is available as a dollar variable in the scripting language. And that's actually the reason why you can use this for a lot of intelligent scripting at the pre-boot stage. Now I activated the boot demo, which IPXE offers over the internet. It just loads a Linux kernel and an initrd. So if you need a quick rescue system, you can use that. And that just shows a few, very few of the options you can do with IPXE in your environment. Again, the fantasy is the limit. A few words about why we're doing all that. Yeah, development is an important part. Upcoming features, I just yesterday talked with the author, UEFI support, so that you can actually also boot UEFI systems, which is really important now because many servers are UEFI only. Very neat, the UNDI-only driver will be optional so that you can always load the FAT IPXE all-inclusive binary and it will try to use the native driver, and if that doesn't work, it will fall back to the UNDI-only driver, which works on any PXE card. And something which we had been supporting through paid development is automated testing, which will be published on the IPXE org homepage. And software quality is always important, especially with so basic features as network boot. Development and community is the reason why we actually consider IPXE. There is a mailing list, ERK channels, you get a response, and most important, there's somebody who takes money for work. And that's how I came to find IPXE. We have a problem with PXE Linux from SysLinux. Over years, I tried posting on the mailing list and asking for help and offering bonuses and money and whatever else to get somebody to fix it for us, and nobody wanted. And I think it's very sad for an open source project if there's a nice software working well, established, SysLinux is really established, but if you have a problem and the problem goes beyond asking on the mailing list, there's no help available. It's really sad. They could do better. We would be able to do more with them if they would allow us, but unfortunately they don't. And actually, Michael answered me privately after my last mail on the SysLinux mailing list that maybe he can help me with an IPXE migration. Yeah, well, Michael actually lives by doing open source development and support, and I think it's a nice example how good software also helps you to earn your living. That's it so far, question and answers. In a few minutes, slides will be up under this address. Please do take a look at my blog, and also please do visit us at the booth in Hall C at the end, where you can learn more about our platform operations and automation, how we run stuff. It's all open source. You can basically build your own Immobilien Scout platform without the software, though. Just the tools are there. Thank you. You mean secure boot over network?
Yes.
I have no idea. I would advise you to use the ERK channel and ask Michael directly. I just talked with him. He gave me those 3 points as upcoming features, and I don't know any further details about them. I'm sorry. Yes, please. No, of course, one network card is enough. The two network card situation usually arises if you have complex VLAN setups or if you want to do Wi-Fi booting, because a Wi-Fi card doesn't have a flash area where you can store the bootloader. So you abuse a regular network card for the flash area, and you do a regular network boot, and then that code switches on the Wi-Fi and continues to boot over Wi-Fi. I've never done it, though. I don't know the details exactly. Any more questions? Well, then I thank you for your time and enjoy the party.